today's video. We have for review a Hobbymaster F104 ASAM in the colors of the Italian Air Force. So we'll begin today's model review with a recap of the history of this aircraft. So for those new to my channel, what I do in my model reviews is I do get into some of the detail of the aircraft being modeled, because the stories behind them go beyond just the pilots and the crews flying them, right? You have the maintainers doing the work to keep them flying. You have the supply officers making sure that parts and equipment arrive on time. You have the scheduling officers putting flight hours together. You've got the people in the back shop maintenance working on the engines and the depot level. And there's so many other roles that are encompassed to make a single flying sortie happen. And those stories deserve some credit when looking at these models, because there's more behind the story than just the colors being depicted, right? So to do justice to those stories and some of the background of the aircraft, I look at some of the print sources and share some history about them. So we'll do no different in today's video. The F-104 story, as many of you may know, started in 1954 when Lockheed engineer Clarence Kelly Johnson interviewed pilots coming back from the Korean War and determined what the next generation at the time of combat fighter aircraft should be. The first Mach 2 fighter, the F-104 Starfighter, would enter U.S. Air Force service in 1958, 4 years after its first flight in 1954. The F-104 would go on to serve in the air forces of over 17 countries, with Italy joining the group in 1962. The F-104 was a popular choice among NATO allies, as relative to the relatively expensive and hard to maintain F-4 Phantom II and other more complex aircraft, it was the highest performance airplane of its time for the cost and maintenance at hand. So the Italians purchased the F-104 and entered service in 1962, with the F-104 Starfighter fleet being upgraded multiple times between 1962 and 2004. The final upgrade was in the form of the ASAM model, a version of which you see here rendered in 1/72nd scale, which included updates to multiple avionics and aircraft systems, including integration of AIM-7 Sparrow and S-Speed medium-range air-to-air missiles, the integration of higher-performance sidewinders, and upgrading of the internal wiring, avionics computers, and updated navigation suite to include GPS. Among other changes, the Italians not only upgraded the aircraft's capabilities, they also upgraded the name. So the F-104 was initially called the Starfighter. The Italians dubbed these the Il Cacciatore di Stella, which translates loosely to Star Hunter. Let it be known that the kids play Starfighter, the real men play Star Hunter. For the most part, the Italians refer to these as the Spillone, which translates to the pin, owing to its relatively slender, low-drag appearance that you see here. The pin, despite what you might think of the name, would developed quite the strong following with the Italian Air Force all the way up until its retirement in 2004 to make way for the next generation Eurofighter 2000 Delta Wing project. During its time, the Italian Air Force F-104 has logged some interesting experiences in its service. One of the instances was a case where, after an Egyptian Air Boeing 737 was hijacked, the Italian government negotiated for the handover and release of the hostages, as well as the disposition of the hijackers. And part of that effort involved the airplane being flown out of Italian airspace back to Egypt. The U.S. Navy objected to this and sent two F-14s to try to intercept the Boeing 737. The Italians had scrambled two F-104s to escort the fighter. And during the confrontation, apparently the U.S. Navy F-14s and the Italian Air Force Starfighters squared off a bit. No shots were fired, fortunately, with the hijacked Boeing 737 landing before either side could do something particularly foolish. But it was interesting that we had a diplomatic flap there that escalated to U.S. and Italian confrontation over Italian airspace. The F-14s apparently withdrew once the Boeing 737 made an emergency landing within Italian airspace, and the incident would be described further in other volumes. So please look into the Achille Laurel hijacking if you want to know more, because frankly, there are, and you could make a longer video than what I'm presenting here about that specific incident alone. The F-104s would also go on to serve in Desert Storm. I was surprised to learn that the Italian Air Force F-104s also flew reconnaissance sorties during Desert Storm. What they would do is they had a Orpheus reconnaissance pod mounted to the belly underneath the airplane, and what these would do is they would fly reconnaissance patrols along the Turkish-Iraq border to ensure that Saddam Hussein's armies weren't making a stealth play to invade Turkey. Wouldn't that have been just a wonderfully messy extension of that war if that had happened? So the F-104 had a relatively long service length, a strange shift from the 1960s all the way to the early 2000s, which is pretty long and does demonstrate just how capable these things wound up becoming before their retirement. A batch of these are actually still flying in Florida to this day. Apparently a batch of around 8 F-104s were sold to a private company operating out of Cape Canaveral, and they do high-speed, high-altitude research and development projects. They're called Starfighters Incorporated, and I believe one of the people that flies for that outfit has a wonderful YouTube channel. I'll put a link to it in the description. So if you want to check out some really excellent footage of the F-104, some of the startup and walk around, you can certainly see it. So Pier Carlo Ciacci, I believe, is his name, and you can also find his videos that way. Again, he's got a great breakdown of the F-104, talks about some of the panels, access ways, how the hydraulic system works, startup protocols, and actually has some footage of some of the flights, including what a supersonic shockwave looks like, which is pretty darn cool. So with all that covered, we will hand off to the details of the model, which is pretty darn good in my estimation. There are a couple of flaws, and we will get to those as we move forward here. So the first thing to note here is that some of the pros, Hobbymaster for the most part gets the shape of the F-104 pretty much bang on, which is really nice. It's one of their better die-cast toolings, and I'm glad to say that there's very little changes that you have to do to make an Italian Air Force Hobbymaster F-104 accurate to the real thing. There are some changes that I made to this model in terms of it being a project, which is why it's labeled as such in the video description, and we'll get to that a little bit later. But again, talking about the pros, they've done a good job modeling the overall shape of the aircraft. Another benefit and the pro column is they've also accurately rendered the missiles. So they have two AIM-9Ls and two AIM-7/ASPEEDs. They don't specifically call out which one is which. The ASPEED is a development of the AIM-7. So cosmetically speaking, they're basically the same thing, and Hobbymaster has done a pretty decent job rendering them. Do be advised, and we'll get to, this is probably a con really, but one of the AIM-7/ASPEED missiles did not fit well on my model. If you all out there have one of these and want to let me know in the comments if you had the same problem. The ASPEED missile on the this side right here didn't want to go into the pylon. It just kind of flopped around and fell out. So I needed to use some blue tack to keep it in place. Not a big deal, but just something to note if you're someone that cares about the fit and finish of it. The other pylons fit just fine. So it's interesting that that one accessory didn't go in, but sometimes that's how it goes with some of these, and that's why I'm sharing it here. Another pro is the small details are labored in Italian and they look pretty legit to the actual airplane. So bonus to Hobbymaster for making that happen. And the cockpit is pretty well detailed. One of the good things about the Hobbymaster F-104 tooling is the entire canopy detaches when you want to change it. So this whole in-flight canopy is one molded piece. You just pop it out with your hands. That makes it very easy to put a pilot figure in, and it also makes it easy to put the three-piece parts in when you want to display it on the ground with the canopy open. Do note that the F-104 has a manual canopy and it hinges to the left when you open it from inside the aircraft, which is why the canopy open position is with a left hinged position. Do note also that if you want to just put the canopy down on the open ones, you can, and it does look pretty good. Yeah, just be advised that you will have a couple of posts on the left side, which is what fits into the corresponding posts on the fuselage. If you want to see some of that in detail, just take a look at the cockpit footage for more info there. So In terms of pros, they've done a really good job with some of the small details. Also in the pro column is the fact that you can get these relatively affordably as of December 2023. You can still pick up some of these for less than about $70 shipped, which is a pretty good deal. It's one of the reasons why I have this in my collection, because I noticed it was on sale with some of the holiday discounts and decided to take advantage of it. So given the airplane's history and some of its capabilities, as well as the fact that I am a Starfighter fan, I had to add it into the collection. And with it being on relatively affordable terms, who could argue with that? So again, at this time, this is a relatively reasonable to acquire model, which is why I like showcasing it. I'm not a fan of doing videos on stuff that y'all can't get. It's just a personal pet peeve of mine when YouTubers do video reviews of stuff and then you get excited, you watch it, you wanna buy it, you hop on Google, you know, whatever, Facebook, eBay, whatever your chosen site of choice is, you go look it up and, oh yeah, the widget is out of stock or the widget is hilariously overpriced, because at the time the video was made, it was reasonably affordable, but in time it got more expensive and you can't get it. So I can't do much about that if it happens over time. The Caliber F-16 that I have a review on is a good example of this, but I do try to get video reviews out of stuff that at the time of publication you can affordably acquire without having to mortgage any body parts or real estate assets in the process to get them. So again, at this time it's relatively affordable and easily ordered online, which is also a good benefit here if you're a fan of the Starfighter. So some of the cons, and this ties into why this is a project video. The first con is, and this isn't something that Hobbymaster can really help, the actual F-104 ASAs were pretty, I'm gonna say dirty, because it's not dirt that you see on these airplanes. It's mostly water, moisture, maybe a little bit of grease. None of it's really a safety hazard or an issue. I know people like to see clean airplanes just because it looks more spiffy or boosts more confidence, but at the end of the day, it doesn't necessarily hurt function to have a dirty airplane. The Italians seem to have kept their F-104 ASAs in a fairly dirty condition. So to mimic that, I have weathered this model a bit. It's something that Hobbymaster really can't do. You know, they're a mass producer of die-cast models, and I'm a firm believer in that weathering is something that the individual owner should do, just because people have very different ideas of what appropriate weathering should be. And there's no way Hobbymaster or any other manufacturer can nail down everyone's preferences perfectly with a mass-produced model. It's just not possible. And my idea of ideal weathering, which is what you see here, maybe your idea of too much or too little. I mean, it really just depends. And the best way to accommodate those variations and impressions is to just sell the model clean. That way everybody wins. If you want a clean one, you get it out of the box. If you want to make it dirty, you can pick up some weathering kit from Tamiya. I personally use the Tamiya weathering powders as well as their black panel wash for some of the panel lines. And the combination of those two accessories does a good job, I think, of taking any die-cast model you want and adding the weathering that you feel is appropriate to the aircraft in question. The other thing too is the, again, I mentioned that the pylon on the right side was a little loose for fitting the Aspeed/AIM-7 long-range missile. Do note you can also equip two AIM-7s, one on each outer pylon. You can also have two AIM-9s, or as I have here, you can have an asymmetric loadout where you have an AIM-9 on the starboard and an AIM-7/Aspeed on the right, just up to your preference. But those are the fittings that I have seen Italian F-104s exhibit in my research. Those of you who have worked on these or maybe flown them, please note in the comment section if you've seen any other payloads. I noticed that some of the stock footage has some aircraft with a pylon on the fuselage just in front of the intake here and running kind of underneath the fuselage. However, in my research, apparently that was never operationally fielded. It was just done for demonstration purposes. Again, those of you that have worked on these in your career, please chime in if that was ever an operational scheme or if the only time these ever carried missiles were on the underwing pylons. So back to the cons. The other con is as a out of the box, these F-104s do not feature one of the F-104S ASAM's most defining features, which is the aft stabilizer fins. So these fins are on the bottom of the F-104 ASA to enhance high-speed stability above the speed of sound. And they were added pretty late into the F-104's career, so most countries that flew them didn't spend the money to add the fins. Most F-104s just had the bottom fin that you see behind the tail hook there and kind of continued here. The F-104 ASA, being a later model upgrade, does feature two fins on the back of the aircraft, and unfortunately, out of the box, Hobbymaster does not include them. So I had to make these. So I took some cardstock, sanded it down, painted it light gray FS36270 for the paint code, if you're curious, and glued them onto the model. So now it is pretty much dialed in for what you would expect it to really look like. It is an interesting oversight because Hobbymaster did accurately mold the cannon port closed, which is accurate because the Italian Air Force pulled out the cannons on these interceptor-oriented F-104s and put the avionics for the AIM-7 missile in their place. So that part they got right, which obviously meant changing the tooling, but they didn't change the tooling a bit for this to include the aft stabilizer fins as well. So that's something I had to do aftermarket. Bear in mind, if you do get this and you care about having a completely accurate presentation, you will have to do that as well for yours. Finally, this wouldn't necessarily be a con, but one of the things that I've noticed in other Hobbymaster reviews is that their engine detail is kind of weak sauce. I would like to see some more accurate rendering of the engine nozzle, especially the interior. Having the interior painted black, as well as painting gloss black on the outside for the afterburner pedals of the upgraded J79 engine back here. I think that just makes the model way cooler. And yeah, it's probably going to add money if you do this on a mass production basis, but I think the detail would be utterly worth it, because just having a gray plastic plug back there, it's really just, it's kind of lifeless. And, you know, we have the technology. Let's make things better, right? So that'd be my suggestion. The only changes I would suggest to Hobbymaster on future F-104 ASA releases, which they are hopefully considering, wink, wink, is upgrading the engine detail a bit, maybe tightening some of the tolerances on the pylon, and then adding the aft stabilizer fins as well. And that goes for any of the Turkish Air Force releases that maybe they may be considering too, since these were sold to Turkey after their Italian service in some ways as well. So with all that outlined, I think this model is a good addition to anybody's collection on general principle, especially if you are somebody that likes Cold War aircraft, or you want to collect NATO country hardware, or if you're a fan of the Italian Air Force. I'm sure some of you are out there, and thank you for stopping by and watching my review. Further, on that note, I'll also extend my appreciation to everyone who is watching this review, whether you're a fan of Italian Air Force equipment or not. If not, and this video isn't necessarily about something you are passionate about, feel free to check my channel for other aircraft model reviews and some historical discussions. I've got over 81 videos at the time of publication here, so then probably have something in the mix that you care about or like and would like to explore further of. So thank you again for watching this video. I also extend my appreciation at this time to everyone who has subscribed. The channel is now up to over 575 subscribers plus, which is amazing. I did not think that I would get that much support for producing these. So I extend my appreciation to all of you who have made the choice to like and subscribe. That's my way of knowing that I'm doing a good job and I should keep doing this. So consider doing so if you like my videos, including this one. That way I'll know that you all care. And it's also going to put you in a position to know via the subscription option and the bell notifications once I upload new stuff, which I will continue to do through 2024. So I'll extend again my thanks and happy holidays to those of you who celebrated over the last 2 weeks, and happy New Year's to those watching this in the coming few days. And we will catch you in the next video. Thanks for watching.